This is Mark Kepler, Purdue University Extension Service here in Fulton County, and I'm out in here in the field with George Crom, a farmer in this area, and we were reminiscing a little bit about some of the old times. We happen to be standing on the same spot where the Farm Progress Show was held back in
89.
Okay, good. Well, we're going to talk today about what's going on in agriculture. It's the middle of June. Corn's been planted, soybeans have been done, and now it's time to do some weed control. And we're going to talk a lot about some of the changes, some of the differences we've seen in weed control through the years. And behind us is a sprayer that George uses on his place, and we're going to go through a little bit on some of the parts of that sprayer that goes on. So George, first off, let's just get a little bit of a general background here. How many acres we're looking at that you guys end up farming and have to spray, and some of the programs that you go through?
We farm our family about 3,000 acres, and then we are also licensed commercial applicators. And so at the end of the year, we'll spray about 14,000 acres, and nearly all of it is corn and soybeans, and a high percentage of that is with no-till farming.
Okay, George, you're a no-till farmer, and we'll go a little bit about no-till farming and what that entails.
Well, no-till farming means that you do not till the soil like with a plow or chisel plow, ripper. The only tillage we do is with the corn planter just a couple inches wide in front of where the row goes, and we leave the crop residue on top of the soil, and it is beneficial for drought years, maintaining more moisture in the soil. It eliminates a lot of labor, and it's been good to us. A lot of beans in this county, soybeans are no-tilled, and corn at a less acreage, but we've been able to do well with both.
Let's go back in history, taking a look at this field, how it was treated years ago. Years ago, this field would have been plowed, it would have been clean tilled, so we don't have a weed or any residue left on the ground. We would plant into that field, and then we would come back with cultivators for weed control to try to do weed control. And then at some point, I mean, we're going way back, we would have been trying to actually go between the rows with a horse,
right,
or a mule to try to get those weeds out of there. Yeah. And it's changed a tremendous lot.
Right. If you go back and do a flow chart on some of those, you might be going over the field 8 or 10 times. And we go over the field maybe 3 or 4 times before harvest. It matters. But since we aren't tilling, we don't have a lot of compaction, and we aren't disturbing the soil. We have lots more earthworms, and natural biology of the soil is able to happen. And it works.
So no longer, because of the sprays we have, the herbicides and the chemicals we have nowadays, we don't have to worry so much about tilling up those weeds to take them weeds out of there. The herbicides are one of the big things that's made this change happen for us.
Right. We started no-tilling back in, we actually tried some in the early, middle 70s, but we went kind of full bore in 1990. And we were no-tilling quite a bit before that. I believe we had the first no-till beans at any Farm Progress Show in major acreage, and they did well. But the thing that changed the world was in 1996, when we had Roundup Ready soybeans come to the market. And those beans, Roundup Ready means that crop will survive a spraying of Roundup, and Roundup is will take out all the other weeds. And that was a major, looking back, history moment.
Okay, that's good to center this discussion of what they call GMOs, or genetically modified organisms. And the way Roundup came about is they took a gene out of something, and it actually was algae, and then put it into corn and allowed that corn then to go ahead and have that gene in it, so it is resistant to Roundup. So we can spray Roundup on corn and soybeans, was the initial one, and have that resistance associated with it.
Right. Genetically modified crops are major for us. At least 90 to 95% of the crop planted has some genetic modification to it. And this corn we're in is Roundup Ready. resistant to Roundup. It is corn borer resistant. It is rootworm resistant and some other resistances. And therefore, we aren't using a lot of chemicals to control those. And overall, the yield has gone up significantly because of that being affordable and works much better than chemicals.
So you're pretty much an indicator of all the farms in Fulton County as far as the fact that the GMOs, not the necessarily no-till, but the GMO type seeds are being used virtually on every farm in a large quantity.
Right. I happen to sell seed, and I didn't sell one bag that wasn't somewhat genetically modified.
Okay, all year.
So we use a tremendous amount of it, and really what it has allowed you to do is it allows you on your farm, well, you tell me, what good does it do for Fulton County because you can use GMO seeds on your place?
Well, what it does for me and others, more yield. And in the end, that's we got to have an income. And I would say, going back in the 90s, we was looking at 100 to 120 bushel corn. And now we're looking at 180 to over 200 bushel corn on non-irrigated ground.
It also allows you to no-till, though, which means it allows the soil to stay in place. By having this residue left over from year to year, it really causes less erosion on this ground, which means less of it's getting washed off this hill, less of it's getting washed into the ditches and actually less of it contains herbicides or even contains the fertility, the phosphorus and potassium is going into our streams and rivers. So really it's an environmental benefit too.
Yes, it sure is. And we just had in this area in over maybe a 10-day period about 10 inches of rain. And we did lose some corn to drowning, but we lost less than if we'd tilled it. And it stayed in place because the corn stalks from previous years and the soybean stubble from previous years that hasn't totally decayed kept that water from just moving and making gullies. And you can walk our farms and there's very little of that happening. I can't say none because that's a tremendous amount of rain, but it's very little.
So we've been able to get from that to a point where we're able to hold our crops in place a little bit better and our soil in place a little better.
Sure.
All right, let's take a look now. Behind us is our sprayer unit. And this is the type of thing that is being used more and more in our area. And so let's talk a little bit about this machine and how it works and some of the functions of the machine itself.
Okay, this machine is a self-propelled one, which is becoming very popular and common. It unfolds, and it unfolds to 90 feet, and you can spray down through the field at about 10, 12 mile an hour, which in the field is a rather rapid pace. We normally spray at about 8 gallons of material per acre, which is a low amount, and it'll apply all types of chemicals. It's got automatic shutoffs, so we do not overlap on any ground. It'll automatically shut off nozzles. It guides us automatically, so we're on the same spot. And in I call it a picture, but there's a screen in the cab that tells you exactly where you sprayed and not sprayed. It works well. We can unfold it here in a minute and see. We got nozzles here, and they're spaced every 20 inches, and those can be rotated, and you got a selection of five if you got nozzles in all of them.
And okay, the nozzles where the spray comes out.
Yeah, the nozzles where the spray comes out. And these are fan nozzles, so they fan out, spraying about 21 inches above the ground, they'll fan out to about 40 inches. So we have a natural overlap, so we get good coverage. When you're spraying, and Roundup's our main chemical in no-till, there is others, but it's kind of the one that forms the backbone. You need to get coverage on the plant, on the leaf, and double coverage. You don't have to have a lot of amount, but you got to get one of those little drops on a leaf.
Okay, so what ends up happening with these nozzles, Roundup takes one kind of nozzle. You're coming out here, and let's say you're spraying an insecticide for some kind of an insect. You just rotate that to a different nozzle that's on there. So there's really, you have an opportunity there for five different nozzles on that that you can rotate back and forth and just change.
Correct. You can just go down through and rotate them. We use O3s and O4s mostly, and those are low volume. But if we're going to spray liquid nitrogen and you want to get 20 gallon an acre on, we have a nozzle for that. If you want to side dress wheat with nitrogen, we have another nozzle for that. So we're basically spraying herbicides. That's our main deal. We can spray insecticides and we do, but since we're raising GMO crops, we don't spray as many insecticides.
Okay, so let's go back to what you were talking about earlier. Well, we talk about the screen and the visual part of it you have inside of the cab. This is working off a global positioning satellite, GPS. And so you know exactly where you're at in the field. Now, does this, some of these will automatically steer. Does this type automatically steer also?
Yes, it automatically steers. You have to turn it at the end of the row. And it works well. But we, in corn standing like this, we basically manually steer it because it, if a row's off a little, you could be driving over it. And so in standing corn, we manually steer it. But we still got the positioning and everything in the cab.
So if you made a mistake planting and got off a little bit, it doesn't know that and it has a chance to drift over onto your row that you're looking at. So it's all right there in that in that GPS. And when we get to a point that we've already sprayed, this system knows it's already been sprayed, so it shuts off that spot, which are parts of the boom can be shut off.
Right. And in this setup, we have five sections of boom. So if you're on an angle or something, it'll just work itself across the sprayer as you come to it, so you don't double spray. And you also spray everything that's there. And if you're coming up to the end rows, it'll shut the whole machine off. You don't have to shut it off. And then when you head back through global positioning, it turns itself on.
Okay, it really saves money is what it ends up doing because you're not putting more spray on than you need to. It saves the environment because we're not putting more spray on than we need to. Plus, at the same time, we're making sure that we're getting all the spots sprayed so we don't have what we call check strips going through the field.
And we've had some of those, but it's eliminated a lot of that. Yeah. And no guesswork.
The check strips are where you didn't spray and all the weeds come through. And it makes a huge difference if we don't have that weed control. So that's really how this system works. And what we're going to do is go ahead and take a look at it, unfold it, see what it looks like, and then go into the cab and see what the system looks like from the inside. Okay, George, as we talk about weed control, let's just take a look at this field we've got here. And you had sprayed this field, or just recently sprayed this field for weed control. And as we look down through there, I see a few weeds, but I don't think it's really tremendously bad. Or is it really that bad?
Right now, no. It looks good, but it also sees some weeds. Since we use mostly contact killers from weed control, the plant has to be up and growing. So there's always new weeds coming up. And we've had good control, and 20 years ago you'd say this is a clean field, but we don't put up with it like that now. And so just yesterday this was sprayed again, and that should be the last spraying. We sprayed two times this spring.
So two things you put on here. One of them was a chemical that was here for the existing weeds that are out here.
Right.
But there's another chemical you put in there for future growth of weeds.
Right. We sprayed this field with Roundup and Warrant yesterday. Roundup's a contact killer and does a wonderful job, but the Warrant has some soil activity for about 6 weeks, and that will control the grasses that come up later.
So let's just take a look at this weed that's standing between us right here. Small little weed growing in the field. Doesn't look to me like a big deal. Why is that such a big deal?
It's a very big deal. That's a giant ragweed, and giant ragweed is exactly what it says. It will be taller than the corn if it's not controlled, and it will reduce yield. I'm not going to say how much, but if it's heavy, it'll reduce the yield 30% or more.
Okay, that besides the fact it will also go to seed,
yes,
and then there'll be more seed here next year.
Thousands of seeds from one. Yes.
Okay, that's good. Okay, well, I'm with George Crom here, and we're inside of this sprayer that we have, and we want to just show a little bit how things have changed in the world of agriculture. And George, at least it still has a steering wheel on it. I noticed that, but sometimes I wonder if they're going to be gone someday.
Well, they may be.
This thing is something that can go by satellite and can be controlled by satellite. And so tell us how this can be steered by satellite.
Okay, this has what we call an easy steer, which is an add-on system. Some of them aren't add-on, but anyway, this little wheel here will keep the row straight and uses the steering wheel to keep it straight. And it's working off of probably 7 to 15 satellites at one time to keep you in line. And then that takes us up to this light bar that's in front of us. And if it's on green, you're on right. We don't pay much attention to it. Then it also transfers over to this monitor here. And it'll paint a picture here of where you sprayed. It gives you your acreage. Gives you a lot of things. Keeps track of farms, what we've done on them. And it also has what we call a light bar across here to just double check that you're online. And it says we're at 7.5 gallons an acre. And then that's where it's set. And then when we're moving, applied rate, that may change a little, but the goal is 7.5 gallon per acre. This red line here, if the nozzles are on, they're green, and there's 5 sections of nozzles plus 2 in nozzles, so you can tell which ones are on and or if you're having, you know, they're automatically shut off.
So this system we have then not only can steer the things, not only can automatically shut off things, but if a nozzle gets plugged up out here and isn't working quite right, it also has a monitor telling what's going on with that.
One nozzle it won't show.
Okay.
I wish it would at times. But plugging nozzles is not a real big thing because everybody tries to keep their systems extremely clean. But it still happens. And we have screens throughout the system to back us up.
Now, I also noticed over here, we're going back to the video games. You got a joystick over here, kind of like thing. We see this a lot more on tractors and modern equipment these days.
This whole machine is hydrostatic, means it doesn't have a transmission. So some of you have lawnmowers that are hydrostatic. As you push it forward, it goes faster. This manually can turn the booms off and on, this middle switch. These side switches can determine the angle at the end of the boom. And they also help you right at the end when you put it in the carrier to fold it up to go down the road. This is a safety thing. If you're in real trouble, you hit that. And then there's a throttle here. We have also manually you can control sections of booms here, and some of these are folding controls. Also, we have a fence row sprayer, or one end nozzle. If you want to get a little closer to the edge of the field, you punch the right one or the left one, and that helps
spray out on the fence row.
Okay. So. All the nozzles overlap each other about 50%, but on the outside one, of course, there's not a 50%. That's why you got the fence row nozzle.
Well, there's a lot of different things involved in this, and there's something that this sprayer's got that's unique, that's kind of new, and it has to do with the lighting system, the lights on this thing.
Right. We got a LED lighting system on each nozzle, and so it works two ways, and we're just learning the system, but the first way is if you run with your work lights on during the day, you can see if the nozzles are spraying right from the cab just visually. And then if you're running at night, they pulsate and you can see your spray pattern.
So like a strobe light.
Yes, exactly. There's like four little lights in each on each nozzle. It's something new. We're trying it. And I think it's going to be beneficial.
So yeah, think about this. When you see a sprayer going out through the field with strobe lights going out behind it, it's something new and different that a lot of us are not used to seeing.
Right, right. But if later in the season now we get into aphids and soybeans and some other things that could happen, there could be some late evening, early nighttime spraying, and that would really be beneficial to be able to see your nozzles.
So why would I want to be spraying that time? Other than to get the job done, what is it about that time of night?
Well,
good?
There's a temperature relationship. It's usually very calm, and when it's calm, you can do the best spraying. And so sometimes that's the best time to kill insects. Certain times of the day for certain insects is a better time to spray.
Well, you mentioned wind, and one of the things we have to worry about when we're spraying herbicides especially is wind and drift. And you also had mentioned earlier that you're licensed to do these fields and to spray different fields, and farmers have certain licenses. Could you talk about some of the requirements, of like the record-keeping requirements and those types of things you have?
Okay, every farmer that sprays should be licensed. And if he is just doing his own work, he's a private applicator. And Mark here trains them, and they have to renew their license or take continuing edge all the time. I used to be that, and then I wanted to do some custom work for some neighbors, and so I become a commercial applicator, and that's a little more training, and we're licensed, and we're also insured different. We're able to go out and spray for other people for a fee. And we do some of that, and part of the reason is it allows us to have a good sprayer for all of it if we can get some extra income. Here in the side of the seat, being a commercial applicator, you need to keep thorough records, and we keep all the records, but some of them need to be kept 2 years. And so here is one that Bill has just filled out. It's one we made out. He has what we've used in the spray combination, the acres, where he did it, the crop, his name. Then it'll go to the house, and we have set rates for these. Nancy adds them in and does them. It takes a little time, but we got to do that to keep track.
Does the GPS system also keep track of anything?
Yes, it does. This system, the way we have it set up, does not keep track of rates. If we're wanting to put a pint an acre on of warrant, it would not keep track of that pint. It would just keep track of warrant and what else you were using. So we got it's a backup for us. But we got a hard copy of paper that if anybody's got a question, we can pull it up right away.
Well, I thought you were taking a look at some of the things and how agriculture has changed in Fulton County through the years, and really the introduction of these sprayers, the GPS systems, and no-till, and a lot of things have come into play here on George's farm. And we go back many, many generations, and the changes with GMOs and the machinery and the equipment and all these different things have come into play to make this farm a tremendously more productive place. At the same time, trying to save the soil and not utilize so much soil. And at the same time, I think farmers of today, and George, you can comment on this, are probably more environmentally minded than ever.
Oh, I'm sure they are. You got to be. If you're environmentally favorable, then your farm's going to do better. And so, and you can't waste chemicals, fertilizer, seed, because those costs are all high. And so it all fits together. You need to be environmentally friendly.
Okay, well, that's our program for today. I'm Mark Kepler, Purdue University, and George Crom, a farmer located just here to the east of Rochester. And thank you for joining us.